Good morning.
Good morning, Pastor.
Good morning. Good to see you this morning. I want to welcome everybody to County Line Church of God of Prophecy on this beautiful morning as we celebrate the 4th of July weekend, the birth of our nation, the beginning of the freedoms that we enjoy today. And we just want to thank God for those. We want to thank God for the ability to come here and worship Him. We thank God for showing up today. We know He's going to be here and reign. We just trust everything that's said and done here will be pleasing to Him this morning. Amen? Amen. I'd like to start off with a verse of Scripture, and it's a verse that I'm sure you all are familiar with. And as we prayed this morning prior to the service, for whatever reason, you can call it what you want, whatever reason, today, I just feel like today for someone is a day of salvation. Whether it be somebody coming up here to this grassy altar that we have this morning, or somebody at home watching on Facebook Live, but I feel like today is going to be the day that someone comes to the Lord this morning and changes their life forever. So let's just continue to pray that that be the case, that someone would heed that call, that desire, that beckoning they feel in their heart, that the Lord puts in their heart, and that they would come to know the Lord today. I know those angels in heaven that sing and celebrate every time a sinner comes to the Lord, they're waiting. They're just chomping at the bit for that celebration to start this morning. I'd like to read 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. Again, a very, very familiar verse to us. Verse 9 says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just and will forgive us of our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Amen. I just trust that the Bible tells us we must confess our sins. The Lord knows that we have sin in our life. The Word tells us that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And in order for that day of salvation to become the day of salvation, each person has to confess our sins. And one might ask, well, why do we need to do that? If the Lord knows all, why do we need to do that? Because the Lord has given us free will. The Lord has given us the ability to make our own choices, right or wrong. And because we have the choice, the ability to make our choices, right or wrong, then thus we also are required to admit those choices when we choose the wrong things. So we must confess and repent. In other words, we just need to admit that we've done wrong. Apologize to the Lord as we repent. It means we're making a promise, an outward promise, that we're going to turn from that way and seek Him from there on out. That's all repent means. A lot of folks think that repent is some mystical word that is going to just magically, quote unquote, magically turn things around. But simply put, repenting is apologizing and letting the Lord know that from here on out, I'm turning from that way and I'm heading your way. And the choices we have to make is because, or the reason we have to confess again is because of our choices. We don't do things based on God's choices. God, if God could choose for us, we wouldn't have free will. And if God could choose for us, it would always be the right decision. How many of us in the car sitting out there or up here on this carport or at home watching on Facebook can actually say that we've made every choice we've made has been the right one? I venture to say it's none of us. So that being said, I just urge you, if you don't know the Lord, I urge you to search your heart. As the Lord lays conviction on your heart today, and I trust that's the case, but as the Lord lays conviction on your heart today, I trust that you look and say, yeah, that was a wrong choice, and Lord, I confess that, I repent of that, and Lord, I know that you died on the cross to save me. And if you don't understand these things, just wait, because the word that's going to be shed today, I'm sure will make that more clear. But I just urge that if you feel that drawing, make that decision that today will be the day of salvation. Amen? Amen. Again, welcome to County Line Church of God. We just want to welcome you here, whether you're here in the parking lot or you're sitting around here, or if you're at home or wherever you are online watching on Facebook. We welcome you. We're glad you're with us. We're glad you're worshiping with us. We just trust that you'd open your heart to the worship songs this morning, to the word that the Lord has provided Pastor Jason. And we just look forward to a glorious day in the Lord. Amen. Speaking of making choices, before I turn it over to the worship team, as usual, I got a story that I heard. I thought it was kind of funny about making choices. Some good, some bad, but it's about making choices. There was a small town in Alabama. It was on a river that fed into a big lake, and they had some big, huge storms. And after the big storms, the fishing was just terrible. People would go out and fish, and these are people who made their living on catching and selling fish. The fishing just went terrible, except for one guy. He would go out every day, and he'd come back with a boatload of fish. I mean, he had more fish than anybody could count. And people were wondering, how's he doing that? Nobody else could catch any fish. And it just kept happening, day after day, week after week. And finally, the local game warden decided he was going to investigate this. So he decided to go fishing with this young man. They get in the boat and they head out, and they're on this big, huge, expansive lake. And the young man opens up a box and pulls out a stick of dynamite. And he lights the dynamite and throws it over in the lake, and boom, it blows up and fish just float to the top. And he starts raking them in. And the game warden said, "Man, don't you know that's illegal? You can't do that, that's illegal." And as he was talking, the young man done lit another one and handed it to the game warden. Game warden, not really thinking, took the dynamite while he's fussing at it. He said, "That's illegal, it's against the law, we can arrest you." And the young man looked at the game warden, he said, "Hey, are you gonna argue or are you gonna fish?" It's all about making decisions, folks. And again, open your heart today. If there's a decision you know you need to make, we trust that today is the day. Amen. Amen.
Thank the Lord. Let's open up in prayer. And let's ask the Lord to bless this service. And let's ask for the Spirit of the Lord to just have His way. Father, we come before You today, Lord. Father, we thank You for the privilege to gather here together, Lord, as Your body, Lord Jesus. We thank You, Lord, for this weekend. We thank You, Lord, for another day to live, another day to move and breathe and have our being, Lord. We realize it is because of You that this is possible. Father, we ask You to be with the remainder of this service. We ask You to touch hearts, touch souls, touch minds, change our lives forever, Lord Jesus. And we ask for Your blessing today, Lord. And we ask You to be with the people here, fill them with Your presence. And we ask for Your will to be done, not our will, but Yours. And we ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. And all God's children said, amen. I'm going to ask you to worship the Lord right there where you're at. As the worship team comes forward, we're going to ask you to worship together. And I don't know if they've got songs right now, but anyways, those who also I want to remind everyone once again, tune in to 88.9 on your radio if you're having trouble hearing. Also, get hot. Feel free to crank your car up. Let that air conditioner blow good and cool on you.
Good morning, everybody. We just want to thank the Lord that we're here today and thank this great nation for those that are fighting for our freedoms, those who have passed on, that had gave their life for our freedom. And we want to thank Christ Jesus for dying on the cross for our sins and forgiving us. We want everybody that, if you feel like it, you can stand up outside your car. We're going to sing some patriotic songs this morning and say the Pledge of Allegiance. So if you feel free to step outside your car long enough to do this and sing and say the Pledge of Allegiance, you can.
Hold it up, Nathan. Don't let it hit the
Jesus.
the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Being a child of God, you just have to believe that God's the Father, and you just have to believe that. Sorry. But just listen to the words of this song as we sing.
I believe was broken, mine was mended. He became sin, now I am clean. The cross he carried bore my burden. The nails that held him set me free. His life for mine. His life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die? God's Son would die to save a wretch like me. What love divine, he gave his life for mine. His scars of suffering brought me healing. He's filled his blood to fill my soul. His crown of thorns made me royalty. His sorrow gave me joy untold. His life for mine. His life for mine. How could it ever be that he would die?
Praise the Lord. Can I hear somebody? Can I get a praise the Lord real quick? Hallelujah. It's good to be back at the house of the Lord. And I would like everyone to be in much prayer. We are praying right now and seeking the Lord on His will, on when is the right time to be back in the house of the Lord. And for those who are just getting here, 88.9, you can tune in on your radio, 88.9, so you can hear. But I asked the church to be praying with me as I want the Lord's guidance on when it's time to be back. I prayed about a possibility of two services, prayed about an early morning drive-in service for those who still want to do drive-in, and possibly a later service, maybe at 10:45 or 11 o'clock, to be back in the house of God. I believe that would give us more of an opportunity to space out a little bit better. So be in prayer. Stand by the phone. Stand by the one call. I'll send word out. But just be praying on whatever God would have us to do moving forward. And we just want to do God's will. How many want to just be part of God's will? That's my heart's desire. Not my will, not your will, but God's will. And I tell you, without the Lord's will, I don't want to do a thing. I believe God's will is a must. We're going to start a new series this morning. And the title of the message this morning is... The title of the message this morning is... It's going to be a series, and it's called Grace and Peace Multiplied. How many want grace and peace to be multiplied in your life today? I don't know about you, church, but I need all the grace and all the peace and all the grace and all the peace and all the grace and all the peace I can get. I need a double portion. I need a multiply of grace and peace in my life. Hey, Barry, can you see if this tent will stretch out a little bit? It looks like it's kind of closing in a little bit. Noah, could you help him? See if it'll stretch out something. It looks like it's hanging low. But anyways, and so as we learn about grace, as we learn about the peace of God, we're going to be coming from the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1. And as we read in the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, there is a threefold purpose. I feel like I can't see y'all. I don't know what it is, but I guess being 6'5" doesn't help, does it? But I'm 6'5", and I feel like my head is getting ready to poke through this tent. So y'all pray for me as I try to get out where y'all can see me a little bit better. And so, praise the Lord. But as we have a threefold purpose in the book of Peter, the first purpose is to stimulate Christian growth, to combat false teachers, and to encourage watchfulness in view of the Lord's certain return. How many know all of us need to grow a little bit more in the Lord? All of us need to be aware when false teachers arise on the scene. And every one of us need to be ready for the return of our Savior, Jesus Christ. And this is a threefold purpose in the book of Peter. Let's give these men a good hand clap. Thank God Almighty. I tell you, I felt like that tent was closing in on me. But here I am now. I can see y'all a little better. And hopefully you can see me a little better also. But Christian growth. Us Christians, we should be growing daily in the Lord. How many agree we ought to be growing in the Lord daily? We ought to be drawing closer to Jesus Christ. We ought to be getting closer, growing in the Lord. I've said it many a times, and I'll say it again. How many would think it would look real funny today if I was up here with a bib on and a baby's outfit, one of those big onesie jumpsuits? How many would agree that's funny? How many would agree I had to grow up, I had to grow, and I had to start putting clothes on that a man wears. And so the point is, it is time for the church to grow. It is time to realize that in growing in the Lord, peace and grace is multiplied in your life. How many would agree in this season of life, we need the peace of God, do we not? We need the peace that passeth all understanding. We need the grace of God in our lives. And I'm thankful for the peace of God. Because if it ever was a time when you watch the news, when there is fear in your hearts, how many know Jesus spoke as much about peace as he did about anything else in his life? And so we need peace. And peace comes through the knowledge of Jesus Christ. And so we need the peace. And it is multiplied. If you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. We're going to start in verse number 1. It says, Simon Peter, a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ, to them that have obtained like precious faith with us through the righteousness of God and of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grace and peace is multiplied through the knowledge of Jesus our Lord and through intimate fellowship with Jesus. And so we know if you're living in fear right now, you can have the peace that passeth all understanding through the knowledge of Jesus. Peter, the writer of this book, through inspiration of the Holy Ghost, knew firsthand what grace was. How many are thankful today for the grace of God? Hallelujah. I don't know about y'all, but I'm thankful for the grace of God. Hallelujah. You didn't earn it. You didn't deserve it. None of us can earn it. None of us can deserve it. But I'm thankful for the grace of God today. Hallelujah. And Peter, the writer of this book, he knew what the grace of God was all about. He was the leader of the disciples. He was the spokesman. I've said it before and I'll say it again. I believe his sandals were flavored sandals, or he had flavored feet, because he seemed to always put his foot in his mouth. How many has ever met somebody, they always put their foot in their mouth? You wonder if they got flavored shoes or flavored sandals or whatnot, because Peter seemed to be the one that always put his foot in his mouth. He denied Jesus 3 times before the rooster crowed, as Jesus prophesied. But Jesus Christ forgave him, restored him in his backslidden moment of life. He repented, and Christ used him to lead thousands to Jesus. How many are glad of this great example of the restoration of a backslidden heart when Jesus comes calling? I don't know about y'all, but nobody gets it all right all the time. And if you've turned your back on the Lord this morning, I've come to let you know that the goodness of God has hunted you down today, and he is searching for you. He is reaching for you. He is after you right now. How many are thankful for the goodness and the mercies of God? Hallelujah. And it was the grace of God. It was the grace of God that reached down and grabbed me when I was in a low, low place. How many remember that low, low place that you were in? When the grace of God reached down and gave you something you did not deserve, you did not earn, but the grace of God reached way down. I'll never forget when he reached down and he grabbed a hold of me when I was in a low, low state. Hallelujah. And when I look around at some of my friends today that are not here, but they're in churches in other areas in this community that I get a chance to minister with, and I've got some more plans in the making to do more ministering in the near future with some of these brothers in Christ. When I see what God has done and how he has taken the drug addicts, the alcoholics, those that have been addicted to things in this life, and he has set them free and delivered them, and he's used them for the glory of God. Somebody ought to shout amen this morning. Because I see God getting ready to raise up people that were once lost but are now found. Hallelujah. I tell you, we serve a Jesus that loves you, that cares for you, and that grace and mercy. And God's mercy is withholding. I've said this a lot lately, as I got this from my brother Ryan. I think a man that he works with was telling him about it. But God's mercy is withholding what we deserve. But God's grace is giving us what we don't deserve. It is that unmerited favor. How many are glad for that unmerited favor we receive of God? You see, when your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, you immediately are written down, and the favor of Almighty God is over your life. Some people wonder, how in the world does Christians receive that favor? Let me tell you something. It's by the grace of God. Hallelujah. And in this season that we're in, we need the favor of God today. Hallelujah. We need the favor of God. Hallelujah. We need the favor of God. And it's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. When you were signed up to receive the favor of God, that unmerited favor that we don't deserve. And so when I think about those that were once in the world but now are found, I've got a testimony that I would like to share. I'll never forget, there was a young man about my age that he was not serving the Lord. He was doing his own thing. And he was out on the streets doing a lot of things that he should not do. And he gave his heart to Jesus Christ. And he's now on fire for the kingdom of heaven. Anyways, I got a chance to talk to him at Walmart the other day, and all he could do was talk about Jesus. I seen him at a restaurant the other day, a week later. He came in and he started testifying about what God has done. Another man that was with him, we were in the middle of Olive Garden, and another man that you could tell was filled by the power of the Holy Ghost, in the middle of supper, in the middle of Olive Garden, he stood up and he laid hands on me and began to pray for me. And the Spirit of the Lord fell in Olive Garden here the other day. And as I stood up from my seat and I went over to pray over their table, the power of the Holy Ghost fell inside of Olive Garden. You know what? I bet people around probably thought we was plumb crazy. But let me tell you about the Spirit of the Lord. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Hallelujah. How many are glad of the freedom that comes from the presence of the Lord? Hallelujah. And as the Spirit of God fell, and I really sensed the Lord really saying through this season of life, so many people wanted revival to start inside the church. But I believe that the revival that we're looking for is going to start on the outside of the church. It might start in parking lots by grocery stores. It might start in restaurants you go to. But if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, shall seek my face, shall turn from their wicked ways, then shall I heal their land. Hallelujah. And I don't know about y'all, but I'm ready to see a move of the Spirit of the Lord greater than anything you've ever heard about. Hallelujah. And so, some of you today, you're saying, I've never seen a miracle. How many know it was a miracle when you trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? You were instantaneously born again. The miracle took place because you were supernaturally born again. Spiritually, as a Christian, you were immediately, this miracle took place, not by works, but by faith in Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. If Christ lives within you today, my friend, you have received the grace of God. You have been part of the favor of God. You've deserved, received something you did not deserve. in the goodness and mercy and righteousness of God, he imparts the ability to believe today. How many are glad that you have a mind that knows you need Jesus Christ? That you have a mind that you know you need a Savior, Jesus Christ? How many's thankful today for a mind to believe, for a mind to be a Christian? If you're thankful for that, you ought to give God a praise of shout today. Because you ain't no better than nobody else on these streets that doesn't have a mind to believe today. You could have easily been one of these people out here on the streets today that is blinded by Satan's powers of darkness, but by the grace of God today, you're at church, you're serving God, you're reaching out and wanting something dynamic today. By the grace of God, how many's glad that the veil that was over your eyes is no longer over your eyes anymore? Hallelujah. The grace of God that you know that you're in need of a Savior. Hallelujah. In need of a Savior. I'm so thankful that Jesus Christ died and rose from that grave. How many remember that day when it clicked in your mind that you knew you needed a Savior, Jesus Christ? Sometimes we get so far ahead, I believe we need to go back and remember that day. Do you remember that day when you repented? Do you remember that day when you accepted Jesus Christ? Sometimes we get so far ahead of ourselves, we catch ourselves in a stagnant, lukewarm state. Do you remember how on fire you was for the Lord when you first received Jesus? Go back and remember what Jesus did for you. I'm thankful for the Holy Ghost today. I'm thankful that the light was turned on in my mind. How many here use your flashlight on your cell phone to be able to see what you're doing at nighttime sometime? Raise your hand. How many use a flashlight if it's not on your phone, but you use flashlights for whatever the reason or the case may be? That light that is turned on so you can see what could not be seen in the dark. If you don't know Christ today, I pray the light switch is turned on for you. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, if you're watching on Facebook right now and you've been debating and struggling, going back and forth on whether you should accept Jesus, my prayer today is not tomorrow, but today. Look at your neighbor and say, today is the day of salvation. And so we know one day we will all stand before the Lord. Every last one of us. How many would agree every day you wake up is a good day? Every day you wake up is a good day. Every day I wake up is a good day. But the day that I don't wake up will be my best day. Hallelujah. Why? Because as a child of God, let me tell you, some Christians don't die. They just transition into glory. Hallelujah. Somebody ought to say amen about that this morning. Hallelujah. Will be my best day. Because Christ is my Lord. And so the question I have for you today, if you don't know the Lord, is where is your citizenship? Where is your citizenship? There is peace in the proper citizenship. There is peace in Christ the Lord. This earth is not my home. I am an alien in a foreign land. My citizenship is in heaven. I've not arrived yet. We are living today as children of God in a foreign land. But as a child of God, we will make it one day to that place of complete peace and joy in the presence of the Lord. 2 Peter 1 and verse 2. The title of the series comes from this verse. Grace. Look at your neighbor and say, grace and peace be multiplied unto you through the knowledge of God and of our Jesus and of Jesus our Lord. I want you to make a note of that verse and use that verse for the rest of your life. Grace and peace is multiplied in your life through the knowledge of Christ the Lord and the grace that you receive in peace through the Prince of Peace. Hallelujah. I'm glad today of the Prince of Peace. I'm glad today of the peace of Jesus Christ. Through an intimate walk with Jesus and the knowledge of God's Word, you begin to understand the peace of God. The grace He has for you that's beyond your human comprehension of understanding. The Word of God has countless stories of men and women receiving the grace of God. You see, everyone you read about in the Word of God wasn't always perfect, were they? The good part about the Word of God is it showed their good things and it showed their bad things. And there was many of times people in the Word of God didn't always get it right and they had to repent of their sins. We must get back to the point of knowing God's Word. You begin to understand the promises of God and the favor of God for you. The only way that you will ever know and understand what Christ has done and wants to do for you is through you finding God's truths in His written Word. Our Father has so much in store for us. How many are thankful for everything He has in store for us today? Hallelujah. I am thankful of what He has in store for us through His written Word. You don't have to go to college to be a mathematician. Peace is multiplied in your life through the knowledge of Christ. God desires to bless His children. If they're obedient to His Word, God wants to bless you physically, God wants to bless you mentally, and God wants to bless you spiritually. How many want the blessings of God today? Raise your hand where you're at. How many want everything that God has in store for you? Hallelujah, hallelujah, to the Lamb of God. And it comes through the knowledge of Jesus. You can't earn it. We don't deserve it, but we are saved by grace. The promises that come with salvation is only by grace, receiving what we don't deserve. I don't deserve to be up here preaching to you today with my background before salvation. I don't deserve to be a pastor. I don't deserve to be a child of God. There are many better pastors than I am. I know that without a shadow of a doubt. There are many better preachers of the Word of God. But how many know by the grace of God I stand here today? Hallelujah. By the salvation of Jesus Christ, I am here today. I thank God for the calling to preach. I thank God that even though I'm not the best, that God is still using me. I know that I'm a rookie that needs all the help I can get. I know that I don't know half of what I need to know, but it's by grace that God has given me the opportunity to preach the good book, the good gospel of Jesus Christ. I got a long ways to go, but I'm glad He's still working on me. Hallelujah. I got a long ways to go, but I'm glad He's still working on me. Hallelujah. And the moment you get to the point in your life where you think you've got it all figured out, you're on the verge of falling down, because the Bible says pride cometh what? Before the fall. And we must be humble. We must realize that God is the only one that can give us strength and lift us up. I realize there are many more qualified than I am. I realize there are many more that know the Word better than me. I realize that God could use somebody way better than me, but you know what? I can't be somebody else. I can only be the best that I can be. You can't be somebody else. You can only be the best that God has called you to be, hallelujah, by the power of the Holy Ghost. There'll always be somebody better at what you do out there. Did you know that? Did you know there'll always be a better nurse out there than you? There'll always be a better teacher than you. There'll always be a better mechanic than you. There'll always be a better woodworker than you. There'll always be a better bush hogger than you. But you know what? We don't have to be better than somebody else. All we can be is the very best that God has called us to be. And there's no need to compare ourselves with others, because the one trick that Satan has is he wants you to compare yourself with somebody else. And he'll feed you a lie and say, well, look at you. You're nowhere near what they are, but guess what? That doesn't matter. All that matters is I've been saved by the blood of the Lamb, and my name is written in the Lamb's book of life, and all I can be is the best that I can be through the power of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. God is so good, and I'm thankful today that Jesus has saved my soul. He has saved my soul, hallelujah. By grace, God has called me, and I stand here today alive through Christ, my Lord. And when I look back at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, 25 through 31, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For you see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. And God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. And base things of the world and the things which are despised hath God chosen. Yea, and things which are not to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him are you in Christ Jesus, who of God has made unto us wisdom and righteousness, sanctification, redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. We ought to give God praise and glory today. Hallelujah. And the point is this. Sometimes people that you think that God wants to use, God wants to use everybody. But the point that I want to make, God will take broken people. God will take people that you least expect, and he will use them for the glory of God. Hallelujah. You see, sometimes we try to figure God out, and you think of somebody so smart and so wise, and they think they got it all together, that's going to be the one that God chooses. But I'm here to tell you that God, when he chose David, a little shepherd boy, even his father and even all the other brothers thought that they were going to be the chosen to be the next king, and they almost packed up and headed down the road. And what does Samuel say? No, where's the other one? He said, I got one boy, he's down there feeding the sheep. He down there tending to the sheep, bring them to me. And when he brought young David, they're from the fields of the sheepfold, he anointed him with oil, and he called him, God called him to be the next king. Hallelujah. The point I want to make is this. When God wants to do a work, don't try to get in the way. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to say they'll never make anything for themselves, because God can take anybody and use them. He can raise up the next preacher. He can raise up the next evangelist. He can raise up the next deacon. He can raise up the next elder. He can raise up the next Sunday school teacher. Why? Because my God takes broken things and he fixes them better, hallelujah, than anything you can ever imagine. Give God praise and glory. Hallelujah. We serve a mighty God. He is worthy of praise. He is worthy of praise. I'll never forget, I've told you many times about the time that I was laid off, but I haven't told you this part of the story. I was laid off from a job about 11 years ago on a Friday. And when they laid me off, I actually had a peace, because Christ lives on the inside. And peace is multiplied. I used to read my Bible on the job, running a dial line. Machine was running good. They didn't care if you read the Bible. I read through that Bible many a times on the clock. How many know that's a good God to give you a job? You can read the Bible on the clock, watching a roll of film run. Praise God Almighty. And everybody in that plant, they knew that Jason Callahan read the Word of God at work. That was just Jason. That was just who I was. Anyways, I got laid off on a Friday. Come home. I was living right here in this parsonage at the time. I remember walking in. I had the joy of the Lord. I knew the Lord was going to take care of us. And I'll never forget what happened. They called me back on a Monday or Tuesday. And they asked me, did I want a job in another department? I said, you better believe it. When do I start? come on in here. So they brought me to a shipping department in DIY, and I got a chance to work there for 3 months. Well, in the meantime of that 3 months, God brought me across an evangelist by the name of Sister Sarah Taylor. And this lady was an on-fire, bold Christian that didn't care what you thought about her. When it was time to shout, when it was time to rejoice, she was going to do that dance and shout right there in the middle of the plant, and she was going to give God praise. Well, anyways, little did I know that Sister Sarah Taylor found out that I did some preaching, and this evangelist had me all over the country preaching the gospel. We would be in front of BG store. We would be down at Eden Mall. We would preach in front of storefronts, on food lines, sidewalks, inside of Eden Mall, outside, down at Eden at farmers markets. She would always give me a chance. But little did I know that God was opening the door for the gospel to be preached. God was preparing me to be a pastor one day. God was preparing me for outdoor services one day. God was preparing me, and if it takes being laid off on a Friday, being brought back to another department on a Monday or Tuesday to come across somebody that God would use in evangelist Sarah Taylor to pour into me, to allow me the chance to preach the gospel. How many know our God's plans, His ways are not our ways. His ways are higher than our ways. As far as the heavens are above the earth, that's how much further His ways than ours are. So if you get laid off, if something happens that you don't plan for, how many know, even when you don't see it, God is still working. We serve a God, if you get laid off from your job, I believe God can give you something better. How many believes that? I heard a true story the other day, true story. There was a man that was starting to go to church, and he was serving the Lord, and true story, and he was serving the Lord, trying to do right. He got laid off from his job. He went in with the pastor and had a meeting with the pastor. He said, I thought my God was going to make a way. The pastor began to show him scriptures about, I can't remember what he told him, but one scripture that comes to my mind is, God shall supply all your need according to His riches and glory. To make a long story short, the man got another job making three or four times more than what he was making doing the very same thing for 20 years. How many know? My God is able, hallelujah. My God is able to provide for you today. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. And so, we must be the best of who God has called us to be. Every saint has a calling by grace. Whether there will always be, as I said before, a better nurse, teacher, carpenter, better tow motor driver, mechanic, preacher, etc. Don't try to be somebody else. Be the best you can be through Christ. Philippians 4:13, you probably memorized it already. Somebody repeat it if you know it. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Be the best Christian you can be through the power of the Word of God and through the power of the Holy Ghost. In everything you do, give it your best shot with the help from the Holy Spirit. Follow Jesus Christ. Live for the Lord. Colossians 3, 23 and 24 says, and whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord, not unto men, knowing that of the Lord you shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. Whatever you do, give it your best shot. Whatever you do, do your very best. Hallelujah. I've told y'all the other day, how many received that stimulus check the other day? Raise your hand if you received a stimulus check. I received a stimulus check that I did not deserve. I didn't earn it. I didn't work for it. But it was sent to me free of charge through the mail. But in order for you to receive the benefits, you had to open it up and you had to deposit it. Today, the grace of God, the mercies of God, and the favor of God, and the peace of God wants to bless you right now. But you've got to open your heart up and to receive through the knowledge of our Savior Jesus Christ. Some of you are wondering, well, how do I have knowledge of Jesus? Through the Word of God, studying the Bible, reading the Bible, having an intimate walk with Jesus Christ. The Lord wants us to be intimate with Him, not just knowing about Him, but knowing Him intimately. I'm going to ask every head to bow, every eye to close. And I'm going to open up this altar right now. If you have anything here today, maybe that you haven't had the peace like you should, maybe you've been living in fear lately, I want to ask you to come right now. If you need prayer for anything, if you need prayer for anything in your body, if there's anybody that you want to stand in need of, any family member that you want to stand in for, I'm going to ask you to come. We're going to pray for you. We're going to ask the Lord to give you exactly what you need, and we're going to pray for the peace of God to be multiplied in your life today through the knowledge of Jesus Christ. I'm going to ask you to come right now.